Praise be to Jesus Christ.
Now and forever.
Thank you for joining us on the Testibus Christi Domini. Today, I am joined with Paul and Louis as we continue our Bible study in the Gospel of Luke. Today, we're going to cover the circumcision of Jesus and his presentation in the temple. We're hoping to keep this talk, this Bible study, under an hour, but just in case we go over that quite a bit, we might split it into two talks. So we'll see how it goes for the entire episode. But, you know, last week, Amanda, Kat, and you covered the birth of Jesus, and now we're going to dive right in that same area and that same time frame of Jesus' life. We begin now with his circumcision and his presentation in the temple.
And I always like, before we do the new part of the Bible or new Bible study, to go back to the previous one. In the previous one, Jesus is born and angels are worshiping God. Shepherds are joining in worship. We spoke about that's where liturgy is born. The heaven and earth unite. It's worship of God, the angels, and the shepherds. And the angels sung glory to God in the highest and peace on people upon whom his favor rests. And Simeon, we're going to see, is one of those people on whom the peace and favor of God rests. And his life is so focused. He knows what he wants. He knows even how he wants to die. And God has promised him even how he will die. God has promised him that he will not die without seeing the Messiah. Imagine that kind of a faith. And church prays the prayer of Simeon, prays it at night before they go to sleep. Monks and church for centuries pray this every night. And they do it in order to say, listen, if I don't wake up, the last thing that I want to do is to be with the Lord, to see the Lord before I go to sleep. And if I wake up and I'm still alive, then I want to have peace of Christ like Simeon in my life. So I don't want to give the whole thing away. Brother Paul. Paul is joined us for the first time. Longtime friends, on fire Catholics. So that's why we call this Catholic Bible study, because we will have different kind of people. So let's read. Verses
21 to 38. Okay. And at the end of 8 days, when he was circumcised, he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. And when the time came for the purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male that opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord. And to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtledoves or 2 young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devout, looking for consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And inspired by the Spirit, he came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now let your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence for all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. And his father and his mother marveled at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, Behold, this child is set for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign that is spoken against, and a sword will pierce through your own soul also, that thoughts out of many hearts may be revealed. And there was a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, and the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having lived with her husband 7 years from her virginity, and as a widow till she was 84. She said she did not depart from the temple, worshiping and fasting and prayer night and day. And coming up at that very hour, she gave thanks to God and spoke of him to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be the Lord Jesus Christ.
One thing that really sticks out to me in verse 21 is, like you said, the name Jesus, that his identity is given at his circumcision when he enters into covenant with God. And what's really unique about it is that in the same way with us, I mean, our baptism is a circumcision of the heart. You know, it is the fulfillment of circumcision where we enter into the fullness of the covenant with God in baptism. So we too receive kind of our identity in our baptism. You know, back in the day, even amongst Albanians, you know, the date of baptism was more important than when you were born. Who cares when you were born? You know, your day of baptism was the kind of, that is when you are born from heaven. So this you see that the Israelites had this custom of naming on the day of circumcision because it gave them identity. And the thing that really sticks out to me too is that it begins with at the eighth day. The eighth day is when he's circumcised, which is according to the custom. But on a more theological level now, the redemptive work of God begins and ends on the eighth day of creation. Because, you know, when you read in Genesis, you think you read the 7 days of creation. And we worship on Sunday. And Sunday is not the Jewish Sabbath. Sabbath is the, you know, the day of rest, the day of the covenant in the Old Testament. But we worship God on Sunday. It's not the Sabbath. And Sunday is not a day of rest in the Old Testament. It's the Sabbath. Sunday is the first day of the week.
Mm-hmm.
That's why if you open up your calendar in the United States, you know, you put up the calendar, the first day starts with Sunday. But Sunday is neither the first nor the last in Christological terms, in theological terms. Sunday is the eighth day of the week. You know, the day that Christ begins his new creation. That's why it's the first day of the week, because now there's a new creation beginning. And we see Luke begins his gospel with Jesus' redemptive work from his childbirth. And we see that it is a new creation. It is a new day. The eighth day of creation. On a more theological and spiritual reading of this passage right here.
Amen. So another thing to see by circumcision of Jesus, he gets enrolled into the covenant family of God. But also circumcision also tells us, because there's so many heresies that came out, and some heresies denied divinity of Jesus, and some denied humanity of Jesus. Mm-hmm. And by circumcision tells us what? That Jesus is really, really human. Mm-hmm. You know, because circumcision is cutting off of part of a flesh.
Yeah.
So he was in the flesh, God in the flesh, and shows us the reality of human flesh.
You know, we were speaking before this about Luke in general and how Luke, it almost harkens to the creed. He was begotten, not made. He's not an angel. He didn't just appear, but he was born of a virgin, and he did things that we do. We're presented. I mean, now, to go back to more of a apologetic-minded, baptism is the circumcision. One is a type of the other. One's a foreshadowing of baptism. But as Christians, baptism is more inclusive, not less inclusive. So circumcision was for males. Baptism is for everyone.
Amen.
And you would think, and what kind of got me into apologetics, at least on this issue, was, you know, you do have Christians that, well, you can't be baptized until you mentally accept, you know, the faith in Jesus. This is even more or less inclusive than circumcision. Jesus didn't give a mental assent. No male at 8 days gives a mental consent. You know, I want to be part of the covenant. Go ahead and circumcise me. Actually, if any man probably, they probably wouldn't submit to this if you did have mental assent with circumcision. But our baptism, it's more inclusive than circumcision is. But like you said, you have the main hair, like modalism, Sabellianism, Jesus, just man or just God. But this goes to show you, I mean, he comes from a family like we do. He's got a mother, a father. He's presented in a temple as a human. Now, granted, just like Mary doesn't have to take this ceremonial bath because there's nothing to clean. Jesus didn't have to be circumcised, didn't have to be baptized, but he does these things so we do them. And, I mean, for him to condescend to have to do anything like this, he's God incarnate. Yet he still does it. And I always said John was my one book if I could take. If I was exiled somewhere and had one book, but Luke does give the the humanity of Jesus. His
childhood, his hidden life, his all of this. Yeah. So let's read verses 22 through 24. And when the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it is written in the law of the Lord. Every male that opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord. A pair of turtles or two young pigeons. So we see now Jesus, the giver of the law, submits to the law that he has given.
I know.
It's unreal to see. You know, it's like he submits to the very law he created. Imagine I create the rules in my own house and I break them. Jesus creates the laws of the universe
and follows them.
And he follows them.
Yes. Condescends to them. Like, he went so low as to die for us. I mean, it's even lower than following your own law. And not even just to die, but to be killed by the same people he came to save.
And look at this, circumcision. Jews also, to a sense, practice circumcision as wiping off of original sin.
Mm-hmm.
Now the Holy Spirit prompts these parents to bring Jesus to submit to, like I said, very law he has given. And not only Jesus, but now Mary, who is without sin, comes to the temple for ritual purification.
Yeah, and we see like this purification of Mary. Again, Jesus did not need to be. What does baptism do? Baptism is really called the baptism of repentance, you know, of repentance of sin. That's what John was doing, right? So as we're going to read in the next chapter, when John was preaching baptism, it was repentance of sin. Mary, in the same way, and Jesus did not need to be baptized. What is he repenting of, you know?
No.
In the same way, Mary's purification is symbolic more than, you know, any kind of affectation, because of course she's pure. She's the mother of God. How could someone be made impure or rather unclean by giving birth to God in the world? I mean, come on. You are the Ark of the Covenant. Rather, you are the means by which the world is purified, you know, rather than you being purified. So one thing that we have to keep note here is that the purification happened probably 40 days after the birth of Jesus.
Because the Jewish women were disqualified from attending temple for 40 days after giving birth.
Mm-hmm.
For ritual purification. This had nothing to do with a personal sin.
Yes.
It's a ritual purification.
Yes, it's a cultic purification rather than anything like that. So one thing to point out here too is the sacrifices that are offered here. We have, well, before I go there, one thing about the presentation of a child in the temple, in the Old Testament, the firstborn that opens the womb was presented to the Lord and consecrated to the Lord. And you see this firstborn attitude in the scripture in the Old Testament was prior to, you know, the Levitical priesthood, the firstborn were considered the first priest. It was the firstborn male that was consecrated to the Lord for priestly service. So you see, prior to the Israelites, when they betrayed God at Mount Sinai, who were the priests? The priests were the fathers of the household. You know, they're the ones who took the lamb in the Exodus and they slayed the lamb. They were the priests. And the firstborn in particular were consecrated to the priesthood of God. So you see that Jesus here, being the firstborn, not just the firstborn of Mary, but the firstborn of creation,
mm-hmm.
okay, takes on the ultimate priestly duty. He's this presentation is kind of foreshadowing his priestly duty in the heavenly temple, that he's brought to presentation in the temple, but one day he will also be presented in the heavenly temple, where he day and night today continues to offer himself and the sacrifice of himself as priest and sacrifice before God the Father.
And it's amazing. Look at this now. Mary knows who Jesus is, that he was conceived miraculously.
Mm-hmm.
She knows he is God's son. And yet now imagine that now. How, you know, we feel empowered when we go present our children to the Lord. We say, Lord, you gave me this child. I know it's mine. You gave him to me. I present him to you. Now Mary goes and presents to the father, father, son.
I know.
But at the same time, her own son. And I found this little meditation from fathers of the church. I don't know who wrote it, but I just want to read it. It was kind of like a meditation of spirit. What Mary said kind of in those moments. What was going on. And it says that with reverence and devotion, she was probably saying, behold, O Father, O eternal Father, this is thy Son, whom thou hast wished to take flesh from me for the salvation of men. To thee I render him, and to thee I offer him entirely, that thou might do with him and with me as it shall please thee, and by him my redeem the world. The child who took, that you gave me, who took flesh from me, do with him and with me what's pleasing to you, that the redemption of the world might come. And in last talk, me and Katrina and Amanda talked about, I was talking about, look at Jesus, when Jesus is born, He is wrapped in a swaddling clothes. There's nothing less. A child plus wrapped in a swaddling clothes, that's the most powerless being in the world. That's it. Can't move. You can't do anything. He undergoes all of that to uplift us. But also, one thing not to forget, to kind of move to verse 24 and the presentation and the gifts that Mary and Joseph are offering. Mary and Joseph are from the lineage of David. They're considered royalty. And yet, they're poor. They're offering poor man's tax. Mm-hmm. They don't even have a lamb. They can't even afford a lamb to offer. They're offering poor man's offering. And I want to read this from Leviticus chapter 12, verses 6 to 8. When the days of her purifying are completed, whether for a son or for a daughter, there shall bring to the priest at the door of the tent of meeting a lamb a year old for a burnt offering, and a young pigeon or a turtledove for a sin offering. And he shall offer it before the Lord and make atonement for her. Then she shall be clean from the flaw of her blood. This is the law for her who bears a child, either male or female. And if she cannot afford a lamb, then she shall take two turtledoves or two young pigeons, one for a burnt offering and the other for a sin offering. And the priest shall make atonement for her, and she shall be clean. So we see in Leviticus, we have a law for this purification for any woman that gives birth to a male child. And for a poor man, offering is turtle dove and pigeons. And this is what Mary and Joseph are offering. The royalty are offering poor man's offering because they probably even under own when and declare the vow of poverty. We don't know. But they're royalty, yet they're poor.
It seems fitting, though, doesn't it? I don't think it was a church father. I'm not sure who said it, but that he entered poor so we could become rich. We like to show him in a manger. And I think we've especially us living like metropolitan, and you know, we live in the modern age. And you say a manger kind of ho-hum. He was born in a manger. He was born in a feeding trough, in a barn with farm animals, not in a hospital in the bad side of town. He was born in a barn, in a trough. I mean, when you say that out of your mouth, kings, royalty, just to say royalty, that's human. He's a king. Wow, he's a king. He has the frailties of us. He's going to die of some disease like us. He's going to be sad. He's going to be hurt. He's way higher than a king. King doesn't even begin to describe the majesty of Jesus, and he was born in a feeding trough in a barn. It seems fitting that they would offer turtle doves. It would seem like it would be antithetical to his whole mission to offer the lamb, and which would be, even the lamb wouldn't even be pleasing. Not pleasing is the wrong word, but this is the Lord of Lords, the one who spoke creation into existence. And to think that they offered a poor man's, like the poorest of man's offering, it's fitting. It's Jesus. Like, it just fits the story. And again, the way Luke hearkens to his humanity, he's so much like us. Like so much like the majority of humans that have ever lived on this earth. He suffered. He didn't go to some big mansion after he grew up. He was like one of the lowly of all trades. He was a carpenter, woodworker, stone guy working with his hands. His whole life he spent living like us.
Yet you always want to advance in the world.
Yeah.
If you want to tell any story, you know, like imagine the ancient people, you would start him off with royalty. Like he's a royal. Or you would start him off with being poor, then eventually attaining richness. You know what I mean? Like kind of like a comeback, you know? But how does that? What's the climax of the scripture? He dies on a cross. You know what I mean? But it doesn't end there. He rises from the grave. Kind of one thing I want to point out too is with the turtle doves and the pigeons, and we're going to see this as a theme in all the Gospels, is the absence of the lamb. The lamb is absent. Not only is the lamb is absent here, but you're going to see at the end
absent
of Luke,
the Passover.
He's absent at Passover. Where's the lamb? You know, because who is the lamb?
Exactly.
This little baby is the lamb. Yeah. Jesus is the lamb who's offered. You know, he's the one, like we said, that firstborn connection, right? In the Exodus, the firstborn offered the lamb, and he who is the lamb is being offered, presented to God. He's the one who you said is not the lamb is not pleasing, right? And it really isn't pleasing to God or efficacious for the washing of sin. But Jesus now is pleasing. This lamb is pleasing to God.
And he's also the priest that offers it too.
Yeah, I know. As a babe. And you see, finally, a worthy lamb has entered the temple to be sacrificed. You know, I meditated on that once before, you know, that Jesus the lamb, finally, a sacrifice has entered the holy place, okay, the holy land, for that is worthy to be sacrificed. That is worth. That is pleasing to God. Amen. Finally, something that is sweet oblation.
And just something that we said in last week's Bible study. He's born in Bethlehem, and most of the lambs that were purchased by pilgrims were purchased at Bethlehem and then slaughtered in Jerusalem. You know, so this whole
the
thing,
typology is unending. Like,
yeah, of course,
everything is a foreshadow, and when you get into it, you're like, man, how did it's glaring. The foreshadowing of everything, even the name Beth Luchma, the house of bread. And I always thought it was funny because in Arabic it means the house of meat, and there's even, I wouldn't say typology because Arabic's more of a newer language, but I even think we forget just he comes from the house of bread, the son of David, who's also the son of Mary, foster son of Joseph. We still call him, you know, his father. But the more you discover this, it's almost awing, where you just want to stand back and go, this was something written before the foundations of the world, but they couldn't see it. We're actually more blessed than even the first century Christians. We have stepped back and we can see how all of these stories just fit together. Well, you imagine the Jews, even in the first century, it took the apostles, that's why all the Gospels, they reflect those different things. We just kind of are lucky. We get it all like already put together. We do. We
imagine,
get to see everything.
Imagine, let's say American football, you know. Imagine getting the playbook of Belichick and all the best coaches ever. You know, I mean, man, you can really run some good plays. That's what we have in Catholicism. We have the playbook of Augustine. We have the playbook of St. Thomas. We have the playbook of Chrysostom. We have
all of them.
And we're like, okay, let's put our game plan together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's almost easier for us. Like, we have a big advantage.
Yeah.
We've had all these great teachers before us who've not discovered.
I mean, imagine football. You know, first guys who started running the West Coast offense. It was like, wow, like a breakthrough.
Shotgun.
Yeah. Now we know them all. You know, it's like Let's move to verse 25 and 26. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was righteous and devout, looking for consolation of Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him, and had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. Whew! This gets you going, your blood moving. I mean, Simeon was promised by God he will not see death until he sees God's promised. But Simeon, not only that he saw him, he held him in his hands. What a power. But you see, everything that's happening kind of in the Gospel of Luke, it's about happening in a temple, and there's always, with all these people that come along, it's always that word righteous and devout. Righteous mm-hmm. and devout. We had forgot that in our century. We look at the preachers who only have a gift of preaching, and we say, wow, what a great preacher. But it's very hard to find righteous and devout anymore. And look, he's looking for consolation of Israel. It's not about him, me, long as my life is fine. No, he wants the redemption of his people. This is the true sign of a sainthood.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, it's funny, when I was younger in faith, I always thought that the power and the awe of preaching is the most important thing. But I'm not really old yet, like you, Louis, but
are you too?
Yeah.
I'm
not but that old. As I've gotten older in faith, I see that this is such an important, this is by far the most important thing, that faithfulness and devoutness that Simeon has.
And look, he's awaiting all of this. And the promise is fulfilled. We can say technically that Simeon is more blessed than Abraham, Jacob, Isaac, all the prophets of old, all the fathers of old. He's more blessed. He's seen what they couldn't.
I know.
The letter to Hebrews, I will read a quote, Hebrews 11:3. You know, when it goes and talks about all the patriarchs and all the prophets mm-hmm. and everything. And then it says that these all died in faith, not having received what was promised, but having seen it and greeted it from afar, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on earth. Hebrews 11:3. So what is going on? All these people have seen the promise from afar. They came close to it, but never fully. Simeon holds the promise in his hands.
I wonder how he felt, though, holding this babe. Like you said, probably swaddled. But our human eyes tell us this is a baby. Like you said, all you got to do is leave it on the table for a couple days and it dies. It can't do anything. It's the weakest of creation. But to know...
He sustains the universe.
Wow. I mean, that almost must have been a mini transfiguration to him. Do you remember the transfiguration? Yeah. Peter, they dropped down on their face. Yeah. This must have been a kind of like a transfiguration, you know, different. But you're holding, you knew at that second. Because he probably waited his entire life.
Some kind of divine light was beaming from the face of Jesus. And probably... we can say through Jesus and his mother too, because you know how many kids were brought to the temple to be presented to the Lord?
Oh, probably all the time.
You know, imagine when we go to a church and there's like 10 baptisms.
You're all
like,
at the same time.
No one can find anybody. Imagine in a temple, entire Jewish nation bringing their kids. How did Simeon know to go to this child?
And he knew right away.
Some type of a divine light was at its display.
Well, he had the Holy Spirit upon him. You know, this is the differentiation between those who know the Lord and those who don't. The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was upon Simeon. This is why he's able to discern out of all these, this is the one. And that's how the Holy Spirit is in our life. You know what I mean? When you got married, you know, when you got married, out of all these, she is the one. You know what I mean? Or, in all decisions that we do, small to little, the Holy Spirit is what guides us. And you see, Simeon, to an an even higher level, obviously, as, you know, as a higher prophet. But one thing that really speaks to is, look what Simeon is looking for. He's looking for someone who will be the consolation of Israel. Israel needs to be consoled because Israel has been devastated by the false gods, by the Romans, by the Macedonians, by the Assyrians, by the Babylonians.
You can keep going.
by the destruction of the kingdom, separating the division of the kingdom, and you see, and just their own sins, most of all their own sins, and Israel needs to be consoled, and that's what Simeon is looking for, and Jesus is the one who comes to console Israel and all the nations, as we will come to
see. Amen. Let's go to verse 27 through 32. And inspired by the Spirit, he came into the temple, and when the parents brought in child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed him and said, Lord, now let thy servant depart in peace according to thy word. For my eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared for the in the presence of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and for glory to thy people, Israel. You see, like you said, all the actions of Simeon are inspired by the Holy Spirit. And Holy Spirit prompts him to even go to the temple. Imagine if he slept that day and said, you know what, let someone else do it. Just today, I'm not feeling it. You are missing on the Messiah. And how many things we miss out just because of our slothfulness, of our laziness, we miss, you know, because if I moved that day and went to church that day, results could have been different. So inspired by the Holy Spirit that came in the temple, and when the parents brought the child to do for him according to the custom of law, he took him in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now let your servant depart in peace. Depart where? He knows there's more than just earthly peace. Like we said, at the birth of Jesus, Pax Romana is not enough. Pax, the peace of the Roman government. Earthly peace is not enough. He says, let your servant depart in peace. What peace? Heavenly shalom. You know, he knows there's more than this life. He didn't wait for Messiah to hold him in his hands and die. He awaited to see him that he might keep looking at him for the rest of his life.
Mm-hmm. And you see that when you see God, it kind of shows the point of Simeon's life. Simeon's entire life was to see God. Like, okay, he probably accomplished things in his life, did things in his life. Like all of us, we don't have a history on Simeon. We don't know what he did. You know, there's different traditions and stuff, but we don't know. It comes out of kind of nowhere in the scripture. So, all of that, in his old age, he comes to see God, Jesus. And he says, I'm done now. I'm done.
What's more is out?
I'm going to become a millionaire? I'm going to become king of Rome? What am I going to do?
This was his climax. This was the climax of his entire life. Probably since he heard that he would see him, everything else was like... nothing. It paled. Like, okay, this is not it.
But not only his life, our life too.
The life of the whole world, forever and ever and ever, of this, everything.
This is the kind of the point is like. Simeon says this, and the church prays this every night in the compline. Okay, these words, Lord, now let your servant depart in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples. I pray compline, and that's. In Compline, and I think it's in Vespers too, every night. And it's like, this is the prayer of the church. Because truly, we can accomplish many different things. You can get degrees, doctorate degrees, become president, become king, become CEOs, whatever you... family, small to big. At the end of the day, our goal in life is to see God. And you know, once you receive grace, it's like, okay, Lord, it'd be great. You know, tomorrow, like, do you ever feel that moment in faith where, like, when you come to the realization, you accept Jesus in your heart and you're just filled with his grace, and you're like, Lord, if I wake up tomorrow I wake up to bless you. Thank God. I got another day. But if I die, I go to you. You know, like, you're just like, peace. If I die, I'm going to you. If I live, great. Another day to serve you, you know? And this is Simeon, you know? Like, I've seen it. What else can satisfy me? What else? The riches of the world? What else can satisfy me? Being king, being... There's nothing else for me to attain.
Well, none of that can even compare to that. The riches, the king. This is fleeting. I mean, Lou, you're about my age. I'm a young 40s.
Let's not tell people about our age, well, okay? They'll just think I
remember
young guys,
being
you know?
16.
These teenagers.
But I remember being 16 or 18 yesterday. 20 years have gone by literally in an eye blink. The things you, the earthly stuff, again, once you're filled with grace, because it changes you. The Holy Spirit completely changes who you are. Like me and you have similar, you know, before I came to the faith, I was a brute of a man. I had all earthly desires, and I achieved a lot of my earthly passion desires. I was, you know, an incredibly successful criminal. I achieved a lot of what I wanted. Never attained peace. Never attained, it was always like an escalator. I kept running, like running up an escalator the opposite way. I'm running, and you never really move because you're always chasing. Once you have it, though, all that stuff sort of becomes like a new car. The day you get it, it's so awesome. In 10 years, it's an old used car. So you've got to constantly keep chasing. But this is the gift, because you don't really die. You don't die. Death for us is not really death. It's almost more like eternal birth. So, of course, he can die in peace. I'm not dying. I'm just going to actually closer to you. And I think as Christians, this was pre-death. Again, we're set further back where we know the promise now and the resurrection. Simeon had faith that it happened, and he's even saying, now I can depart in peace. We know what happens. Like, we know the end of the story. He only knew the beginning of the story. Yeah. He knew he would see the Christ, but I don't know if he knew the whole story of what the Christ would do.
He didn't see the miracles. He didn't witness anything.
None of that. We get to see that and the fruits of it through history. Again, we're blessed. Although I think Simeon was supposed to be born in that time, just like we were supposed to be born right now. We like what we're doing right now, we're supposed to be doing. We all have these Simeon moments, the kind of the climax of our life, what we were, because I think we found our mission. Before that, I had no mission. I just wanted to get rich. And yeah, it was a typical worldly stuff. The Holy Spirit gives you your mission. You finally can meet your true climactic, the meaning of why God created you. And Simeon seen his. So we're all kind of going to have our Simeon moment. Which is
and that, for me, the most powerful, one of the most powerful, probably even writings in a whole New Testament is this part, you know, with Simeon, especially verses 28, 29. He says he took him up in his arms and blessed God. He took up whom? He took God in his arms and blessed God.
Yeah.
It's like, ooh, I mean, cool. I can't even wrap my hands around it, man. You take God in your hands and you bless God. I mean, God's supposed to bless you, you know. There are two things in here that kind of like I see. He's blessing the Heavenly Father. But at the same time, the God-man, Jesus, is in his hands. You know, it's like the one who upholds the universe, who holds the universe in his hands, it's now held by Simeon. Let's go further, like you said. We all have moments of Simeon. Of course we do. Mass is this.
It is.
It's one of my favorite parts. Man, this priest, man. I mean, woo. We just want to talk today about good things the priests do. Holding the Eucharist in his hands, you basically do what Simeon does.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, let your servant depart in peace, for my eyes have seen salvation. Even us, believers in the pews, we can say the same thing. My eyes have seen thy salvation. I have touched you We actually went even further.
We get to receive him.
Exactly.
The glorified Christ. Not the Christ child, but the glorified true divinity of Christ. Now, granted, you can't separate divinity from humanity. So, of course, he was holding both. But we receive the whole thing. That was like my... That was my... When I came into the faith, realizing that, and then after then doing it, the first time I received it with like... complete knowledge and faith. That was, I think, my first Simeon moment. Mm-hmm. Like, I can't believe I'm even allowed to do this. How is he going to do... How is this possible? But the Holy Spirit just kind of lets you know what you're... And it's funny, I remember the words I said, and the more converts I talked to, I found out this is almost the same thing. They all say the words of Thomas. The first time I knew my Lord and my God. I remember saying that, like, it was almost like, oh my hair's standing up. It was almost like you, it's the Holy Spirit. There's no words that, it's like trying to describe the color red to a blind person. There's certain things words can't convey to somebody. You have to feel them. And when you know, and I remember saying those words, and the more converts I speak to, it's the exact same things they say, my Lord and my God, I can't believe this is, it's a Simeon moment. I can die now. I can die in peace. If I die today, God bless you for the days that you've given me, because there's nothing more I can have.
And look what Jesus says later on. What does he tell the apostles? Blessed are the eyes that see what you see. Mm-hmm. Jesus says that later. Basically by that, you know, probably that, you know, divine glory radiating from the face of Jesus, Simeon is probably just hearing the words of Jesus before he spoke them later on to the apostles. And he's holding him and probably... He could read from the face of Jesus saying, blessed are those who blessed are you that see what you see. He says, you know, he's blessed to see what he sees, to see the face of Jesus, radiant face.
It's amazing.
Christ.
Yeah. And just to tie, before we go on to the next verse, how you said talked about earlier how holding the swaddling infant in your hand, how do you think about that this is the God-man that holds the universe? In the same way, kind of reflecting on the Eucharist, when the Eucharist is on your tongue, do you think, wow, this little host, Jesus humbled himself to become man, but he continually humbled himself to become bread. You know what I mean? And this host in my mouth, that's melting on my tongue, is existence itself. The one who holds, the one who is to be itself. As St. Thomas Aquinas says, the one who is causing, not just me to be, causing reality. He's the one who's moving Jupiter across the sky, unbeknownst, not even knowing to us, all those planets and stars that we don't even know about. He's the one who's moving them, the one who's in my tongue right now. And that same prayer should be in our hearts that Simeon has. And kind of going to the next verse, or verses 31 and 32, because we're focusing on the first few verses, but which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples. This is something that I really struck me, that God is showing his salvific work in the sight in front of witnesses. Like, look what I am doing to my salvific work is being presented in front of you and in front of the enemies of Israel and in front of the devil. Like, watch all you witness right now from this moment. I mean, the devil's there. He's probably seeing these. The devil is tempting people there in the temple, you know, in front of them, in front of the enemies of Israel. God is like, look, I am right here. I will slay you, enemies of Israel, starting with the devil and all the worldly enemies. I will slay you with this child. You know what I mean? And all the people here witness what I am doing. And look, because of God's salvific work happened in the presence of the people. It didn't happen in secret, you know? It happened in the presence of the people. We now have the testimony of those people that were present. This is what it is, the presence of the people.
Amen.
Who are the people that are present? These people. And we have their testimony. We're reading it 2,000 years later. Yeah.
And that was very powerful. They said, even in face of enemy, even in face of devil, he's preparing the salvation of people, you know? That's why one of my favorite verses from Psalm 23, that says, mm-hmm. You fill my cup with oil. You throw a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You know, and look at this now. The salvific plan now. You see how it keeps moving? The Simeon is awaiting the redemption of Israel. But look, it's going to Gentiles. Verse 32, like you said. It says, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory to thy people, Israel. light to the Gentiles now, but glory remains with people of Israel. You know, glory comes from them. But this glory now, it becomes light to the Gentiles. And I don't know how Jews were. Why were they pissed when salvation went to the Gentiles? Because I just want to read a few verses from Isaiah about the prophecies that Messiah will bring light to the Gentiles. Isaiah 42, 6 and 7. I have given you as a covenant to the people, a light to the nations, to open the eyes that are blind, to bring out the prisoners from the dungeon, from the prison, those who sit in darkness. This is what the call of Messiah is. This is what Isaiah prophesied 700, 800 years before Messiah came. And Jews kept reading this, light to the Gentiles. And they missed that light, but Simeon didn't. You know, a lot of Jews at the time didn't, but majority of them did. Another verse from Isaiah, it's 49:6. It is too light a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved of Israel. I will give you as a light to the nations that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. It is too little, God says, for my Messiah only to deal with the tribes of Jacob. It's too little. He's too great for it. You are given as a light to the Gentiles to bring salvation to the rest of the world. I mean, imagine if your son is can save people. Would you be confined just to tell him, okay, just save people of your village?
I know.
Or man, if you say you have those powers, save the world.
Everyone.
Go out, do something for the world. And this is what Messiah did.
Mm-hmm. You know, one thing to notice here too is that the Gospel of Luke is linking to now the Gentiles. The Gospel of Luke is written for a primary audience of non-Jews. Because like, and we can discern this because Luke says things that a Jew would know, and even like about the presentation, okay? Time came for purification. According to the law of Moses, they brought it up to Jerusalem, like a Jew knows.
Like three times, you know, he has to explain the law of Moses in the Torah.
If I were telling you, I bathed as a baby, what we did is we went to church, and the priest got some water and poured
exactly.
It
down.
Exactly.
I know happens to because the Catholic man. Church teaches that you have to.
You're like,
yeah,
guys,
I know.
It's so annoying, man. Just get to the point, okay? Like, get out of here. You know?
I know. So you see that this light of the Gentiles is being presented through Luke, too. You know, it's very special to Luke's heart because, obviously, this is coming to the Gentiles through here, but one thing I want to so we all know, I think it's a very popular knowledge to know that obviously the chosen people of Israel God has prepared, and then from there Jesus came to bring salvation not only to the Israelites but to all nations. But I think that and we always focus on the rejection of Israel of Jesus, which is true. Israel rejected Jesus, but There's this you know, the glory of Israel here that Simeon talks about, that we can't forget that Israel kind of, for most of its history, I mean, there's exceptions, but for most of its history, constantly rejected God. It wasn't like they just rejected
over and over again.
They rejected Jesus. It's like, oh, this is the first time they rejected God. Like, no, you've been rejecting God over and over and over.
That's why you were conquered by all those enemies.
Exactly. But there was always a faithful remnant in Israel. You know, there was always a
prophet being raised up to bring them back.
Exactly. So even though the Jews are the ones who, you know, brought Jesus to be executed, you know, and it was, obviously they reject Jesus even to this day. There was a faithful remnant of Israel.
So you see, from the beginning, as we said, the plan was for Messiah to bring light to the Gentiles. So let's move to verses 33 to 35.
Oh, I've been waiting for this one.
And his father and his mother marveled at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, behold, this child is set for the fall and rise of many in Israel, and for a sign that is spoken against. And a sword will pierce through your own soul also, that throughout of many hearts may be revealed. The thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. Look what is happening here now. First of all, Simeon is speaking to Mary. You know, I believe and I guarantee that when he did his circumcision, he never spoke to other mothers. But he's speaking now to Mary because she is the mother of Jesus. You know, And it says, she spoke to the mother and said all these things about him. And he blessed them and said to Mary, behold, this child set for the fall and rising of many. And he will be what? A sign that is spoken against. What is this sign, first of all? He's speaking to Mary, but this word sign in the Old Testament. What's a sign in the Old Testament? The sign is Isaiah 7:14. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall name him Emmanuel. Now it says this child will be a sign, and Mary is part of the sign. Mary is also a sign for Jews. Mm-hmm. Why? Because she's that virgin that bore a son. And through him, the thoughts of many will be revealed. What does that mean? Those who will reject the Messiah, their thoughts are revealed. Those who accept the Messiah, their thoughts are revealed. So this child becomes like a stumbling block.
Yeah.
For those who reject him.
Big time.
And becomes salvation for those who accept him.
I was waiting for this one verse out of all of what we read. After knowing what we know about Jesus, who he is, Mary, who she is. So he says this, and his father and his mother marveled at what was said about him. They marveled. Like you said, they knew. Like, Joseph really knew that this was a miraculous birth. Mary really knew this was a miraculous birth. Yet they marveled at hearing these words. They shouldn't have marveled at all. Like, yeah, I know kind of who he is. Yet they still marveled. And I always like to think, why? Why did they marvel at what he said? Now, I wonder how Mary thought. Do you think Mary knew? Now, it was revealed to her by the angel that she's going to have a son. What to name him. But did she know that he was going to die the way that he did? Because you know that in the script, I don't think the apostles had any clue about what was going to happen to him. But when he said, and a sword will pierce to your own soul also, I would expect her to marvel after that. That always kind of, to think of them marveling after Simeon saying this, it was, I wouldn't marvel after someone telling me something I already knew. So this was kind of a revelation to them. So we kind of see that Simeon's kind of a prophet. He's kind of saying something prophetic. If
Holy Spirit's upon him and Holy Spirit makes a prophet.
He's prophesying to her.
You know.
I wonder how, and again, Luke kind of does this. It makes you ponder humanity. How did she feel when she left there? Do you like when we do something like this, I'll be filled for the rest of the day. Like whenever you, I go to church, I walk out brimming for the rest of the day. How did they feel when they walked out of the temple? I mean, they had to have a bunch of feelings. They were human. Do you think Mary kind of thought about that? Like, sword's going to pierce my soul also. I guarantee she wasn't afraid, but she guarantees she felt different than when she walked in that temple.
It's not a pleasant...
Not at all. No. Especially knowing who the child Jesus was. This is a great...
Yeah.
I love this one in the mysteries in the rosary. It's one of my favorite ones, the rosary to pray.
John Paul II actually said for this word, sign again, Simeon in Greek. That's why I pulled out my Greek Bible. This sign, he says, it's a sign that at the same time shines, but at the same time sign of contradiction. It all depends. You can accept it or reject it. If you accept this sign, it's going to shine. Like you said, you will beam. If you reject it, it's a sign of contradiction.
And you
stumble. It's a stumbling block. You know, you will fall. And this word in Greek, sword can also mean like a dart. You know, I have more of like an image of it can mean a sword or a dart, but more of like a dart. You know, like a dart in your heart. You know, like but it could also mean a sword. But I mean, let's connect this a little bit to the moment when Jesus actually died, and it was that actual piercing, you know. What happens? The soldier just pierces the side of Jesus. Mary felt that piercing at the same time, you know, because the mother her flesh was pierced. And her heart at the time was pierced. It's like putting two people next to each other, you know, or back to back, and going with the same sword and piercing their hearts.
It's very easy for any of us who have kids. All three of us have children.
Just reading my mind.
And it's like, could you any harm, any serious harm? Like
you suffer.
It's the same. It's the same pain. It's your flesh. Your flesh. It's an extension of your flesh.
Now imagine, though, our children are only part us and part our wives. Jesus is all Mary. That's where he got his flesh from, one person, not two. So Mary's more intimately connected to him than we are with our children, because it's my child and my wife's child. We both suffer. Imagine Jesus must look just like Mary. Or else his whole genetic code he got from one person. So that link, that's a very unique, that's never happened on earth, the virgin birth. Everything he got, material-wise, he got from her alone. So it's a unique suffering, even spiritually, but even bodily. What is that link of a mother's son who has no father, earthly father? All his flesh comes from her. She almost could maybe see part of herself up there. Because it's only her and him, no father. That's even hard to contemplate, because it doesn't make sense to our carnal minds. But again, this is real. You know, it's not a fairy tale. What she had to have suffered is, I don't know if we could comprehend that kind of connection with somebody.
And look at also this, when Simeon says, the thoughts of many will be revealed because of this sign, you know. Thoughts of many. Thoughts of Jews who plotted to kill Jesus. Thoughts of disciples, and their weaknesses were exposed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, all of this done at the cross. So cross, in the end, is that? Sign of acceptance,
yeah.
Or sign of rejection of God. And this is very crucial in our spiritual life. The cross, that's why Jesus says, blessed are, if you want to follow me, take up your cross and follow me. Cross is a place that distinguishes true disciple from a fake one.
Mm-hmm.
Because many people can sing hallelujah when all things are fine. But when crosses comes, do we bear that cross and follow him, or do we reject him? You know, and this is especially for me, because I don't like the cross.
And I don't think anyone likes the cross.
You know, so this is that sign. So let us move to verses, grab my English Bible. Verses 36 through 38. And now we're going to talk about prophetess Anna. You said Simeon prophesied in the spirit.
Definitely.
Anna now is known as prophet. Imagine now, Jews for all this time had no prophet since Malachi, 400 some years. But the time of Messiah, the prophets are rising. You know, now we see Anna, Simeon in a sense is prophesying. John the Baptist. We see Elizabeth kind of in the spirit, yeah. Proclaiming things. Even Zechariah when he comes
to
fullness of truth. So now, when God comes and the Spirit of God is present, the
prophets, all of a sudden they pop out of the woodwork.
Yep, that's it. You know, the prophets are here.
Yeah.
And sometimes, unlikely one. Because Anna, the prophetess, you're like, what? I heard about Isaiah, Jeremiah,
where did she come from?
Yeah, who is this lady? Yeah. But let's read this. And there was a prophetess Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age, and having lived with her husband 7 years from her virginity, and as a widow till she was 84, she did not depart from the temple, worshipping with fasting and prayer night and day. And coming up at that very hour, she gave thanks to God and spoke to him, to all who are looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. You see, that final word, spoke to him, to all who were looking for the redemption of Israel. She's prophesying to all. It, again, came at that very hour. Wow.
Because she was a prophetess before that. So she was a believing Jew for what?
The probably
she was
taught,
84 years old.
They probably taught young girls,
yeah.
In the temple and all of that.
And she's seen it too. It's, yeah, I never really thought about it like that. It was hundreds of years from a prophet. And, you know, you went into the times of the Maccabees. no prophets. And now all of a sudden, it seems like as soon as the Shekinah, the cloud, descended on Mary, then all of a sudden things started cooking. It was almost like once the cloud came and overshadowed, then things, prophets start coming out of the woodwork. Now, she was already a prophetess. But a prophet, almost a, they're like transitional prophets. They're Jewish prophets of the new covenant.
Yeah.
Where, same with Simeon. Simeon didn't just become an after Christ.
This is powerful, they says now here. She just doesn't prophesy now in a long future. She said, she spoke of him to all who were looking for the redemption. Now, spoke of him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, spoke of the one who's there.
It's amazing.
And you see now, Anna, I kind of want to link this first verse. There's one line, but it's packed. The prophetess Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. I guess I'll start with Phanuel first, the name Phanuel. I'm going to go to Genesis chapter 32, verse 30. Read to you guys real fast. Verse 30. So, setting the scene. Jacob has just wrestled the angel. In the Old Testament, you know, in the Old Testament, Jacob is going and he comes to rest and he falls asleep and he has a dream of wrestling with the angel, God, right? And so, right, this is the scene, right? He just wrestled God, and I'm reading verse 29. I'll start with 29 and continue. Then Jacob asked him, "Tell me, I pray, your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." And you see, the name Peniel comes from that Peniel. Face to face. That's what it means. Face to face with God. And you see, Anna, the prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel, right? What is she seeing with Jesus? She's seeing God face to face, and her life is preserved. And there's like this image that people, you talk about the humanity of Jesus. Now look at the divinity of Jesus being presented here. That yes, he's fully man, but he is also fully God. That Anna is face to face with God
and knows it too.
Yeah, and look at this now. Like you spoke in our Bible study when we did as a group. St. Ambrose said that she could have been a widow for 84 years old. Not only 84 years old, she could have been a widow for 84 years old.
It's one interpretation
and,
of the passage.
And, and look at this connection now. Mary is known as what? As Virgin Bride of Israel. She's the virgin. And now Anna is the representation of a widow. But what's the significance? The significance is that people of Israel, because they had no prophets at the time and nothing was moving, they were almost like a widow. They had no husband. And that's why God has promised that he's going to become their bridegroom. Your maker will become your bridegroom, you know, in Isaiah. You see, so 84 now, again, 84 years of widowhood. Some of the commentaries that I read said 84, it's 12 tribes of Israel times 7 times perfection. 84 years of widowhood are waiting for what? To be wedded. By whom? By God, their own maker. So now Anna, the daughter of Phanuel is a well-known guy at the time, probably, you know, which means face to face. Now Anna, the widow, is face to face with a God who will marry her and her people. You know, so beautiful. You know, she's no longer a widow now. She has a bride.
Yeah.
The bride is Christ.
Anna is a very mystical person here in the scripture. Like, there's a lot of mystery around
almost
her.
Like Melchizedek-ish.
Yeah,
like, pops out of nowhere, but plays this huge, significant role, but not spoke of that much.
Yeah, because you see here one thing that's that's said about her, not only who her father is, but she belongs to the tribe of Asher. Now, think about when this is occurring. The tribe of Asher, That's part of the northern kingdom. That has been lost. That's been conquered. It is one of the lost tribes. It's been scattered. There is no tribe of Asher in this time. But yes, she remained in Israel, part of the tribe of Asher. It is like it's a mystery there, you know, because to go back to biblical history, you know, how long before was it 800 years before before the time of Jesus that the kingdom was divided?
Around
that time.
732.
So, BC.
732 is the northern tribe is conquered.
Conquered. Actually. So it's about a little bit before that. So it happened several. Almost a millennia before the time of Jesus. The northern tribe is divided by the southern tribe. And in the northern tribe, you have the 10 tribes. And in the south, you have the Benjaminites and you have the Judahites. And you have most of the Levites as well. And in the north, you have 10 tribes. One of the tribes was Asher. And they were conquered in 732 by the Assyrians. And they were scattered. And over the centuries, they were lost. There was no... They are amongst the people. They are amongst... They were, you know, that's what they say, that's how the Syrians conquered. They exported half of them to the foreign nations so they could marry off foreign nations and be melded, and then took the other, took people from foreign nations, brought them to the land of Israel so they could mix with the people that were remaining there, and they lost their identity. So the Asher has been lost for centuries. Yet now, you see this tribe, this woman from the tribe of Asher, because one of the prophetic promises of the Messiah was that he would unite the tribes of Israel. Now, how could you do that? They're lost. You know what I mean? How can I? It's like throwing feathers into the wind. You know, and going collect the feathers. You know, it's like it's lost.
So she's a remnant.
It brings together the mission of the Messiah. Because what does Jesus do? He brings the 10 tribes that are lost back to God, back to the kingdom. How does he do this? Because Jesus now is not only for the Jews, but he's for all people.
He redeems all people,
nations. Yeah. So whatever the tribe of the tribe of Asher was lost to, whether they were sent to Albania, whatever, hypothetically, right?
Giant kingdom.
You know? And they were lost there. Now, through the baptism of Albania, they're united back to the kingdom. And you see that her identity is kind of prophetic, that she's a daughter of Phanuel and she's from the tribe of Asher, that Jesus has come to bring the lost tribe, the tribe of Asher, and all the lost tribes back to the fold of Israel in Jesus, who conquers all nations.
Amen. I think that's very beautiful for us also to conclude with that, and just to conclude with how did Anna live, and for us to try to orient our lives to live like Anna.
Sure,
she said she served God with prayers, and fasting. You know,
night and day,
and this word serving is. This is where we get the word liturgia. Laterusa. Basically, she's giving worship to God, the worship that is due to God.
Latria.
And this is what we need to do. We did latria to God. We need to give him worship that is due to him. It's due to worship God. So let us conclude with a prayer. And stay tuned. Next week, we will do... Now, Jesus was presented in the temple as a 12-year-old, goes to the temple and wants to spend some time in his Father's house. Stay tuned. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord Jesus, we thank you and we bless you. We thank you that our eyes have seen what they've seen. We thank you that our ears have heard what they heard. They heard of you, Lord. And in Eucharist, we see you as Simeon. So give us a heart to be always ready to say, I am ready because my eyes have seen the salvation, because Lord, you are our salvation. And we desire to worship you, Lord, to give you latria, to give you what is due to you. And we pray this in the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for watching our content. If you like this video, please subscribe and join the cloud of witnesses. Also, don't forget to check out the recommended videos on the screen.
and our playlists. God bless you.